Alejandra Rosero, and I will be speaking today about immigration and refugee centers in the U.S.
Más despacio.
Okay. Ah, all right.
She's so, cooking herself. She's cooking herself.
Is it me?
I can't see it on my glasses. Is this on slideshow? Wait, slideshow.
There's something. Yes.
There you go.
Okay. So, as an introduction, I would like to explain first how the intention of immigrants work, right? So, there are a lot of variations, but this is most of the people who are currently detained in immigration detention centers. So, they basically arrive to the border, which is usually the Texas border, the southern border, and people are placed in something called expedited removal, which is that they can be removed or deported without seeing a judge. So the only way to see a judge is if they express fear of return to their countries in order to start their asylum proceedings. If they don't express fear of return, then they are removed by the border patrol officers or deportation officers back to their countries. And if they do, they are placed depending on what category you are. So UCs, unaccompanied minors, and AWCs, adults with children. So the UCs and the adults with children are sent to processing centers, and adults too, which I will explain in more detail in a bit. And then this is where the border patrol agents and deportation officers start asking questions about their fear of return and basically decide whether they do have a real fear of return or not. And all of this documentation is later used in court. So if they are families and or children, they are sent to ORR, which is the Offices of Refugees Resettlement, the unaccompanied children. And if the children are with parents, then they are sent to the family detention centers. If the adults come without children, then they are sent to the adult detention centers. So for the family detention centers and ORR, they are usually released under order of supervision, which means that they have to report themselves to ICE wherever they're gonna go, or they are released if they are adults with an ankle monitor. So immigration can monitor where they are and make sure that they will attend to their court hearings and all of this process. But if you're an adult, then you're either, depending on how you entered, might have a bond hearing, which is when a judge will decide whether the person is a flight risk or a danger to the community, and grant a bond, which the minimum is $1,500, but they never grant that. It's usually $10,000, the average. And of course, there's other people who do not have families or money, so they end up doing their entire process detained without an attorney. Yeah. So okay. So these are the hieleras or ICE boxes, which are the processing centers. These are the first detention centers where they are placed when they are processing their fear of return, right? So these, I mean, they call it hieleras because it's supposed to be extremely cold. They are mixed children, mothers, adults. So you can see like the conditions are very terrible. They're supposed to not be there for more than 72 hours, but in most of the cases they are, they remain there for more than 72 hours or days. And it's really bad. They don't provide them with food. I had a client, a 7-year-old client, unaccompanied minor who stayed at one of the processing centers for over a week. And he said that They only give him like little cookies and a little juice. So it's really bad. It's in the processing centers, yes. So my presentation was interactive, but I don't know what's going on, but it's fine. So there are 209 immigration detentions in the United States, which is insane. I mean, these are people who the only crime that they have committed is, and remember, if they are placed here, it's because they express fear of return, meaning that they qualify for asylum, right? So, well, and then there are three family detention centers. Which the family detention centers are the ones that mothers and children are placed. And most of these detention centers are owned by GEO and former Correctional Corporations of America, which is now CoreCivic, which, as you all know, that those are the private corporations that own the prison industry in the United States. And the cost, I think this is really unreasonable too, because it's $124 per adult per day to detain them, and then it's $343 per person, meaning per child or mother and mother at the family detention center. So they are making billions of dollars out of these people. This is one of the adult detention centers. I used to work here. Well, I didn't work for them, but I used to be a legal orientation program provider, because since they don't, they folks are supposed to have a right to for an attorney, but it's not like in the criminal system that the government will pay for the attorney. They have the right, but they have to afford it themselves. So there are so many immigrants detained that there are not enough lawyers to represent them. So what we did is basically do pro se clinics, which is teaching them how to represent themselves in court. The conditions, I mean, the standards are terrible. There's, as I said, no right to legal counsel. They lack proper medical care. For example, in 2015, at one of the family detention centers that I used to work there too, providing same services. They, at Dilley, Texas, one of the largest detention, family detention centers in the US, they gave the children a dosis of the hepatitis A, the adult doses. Yeah. And the children were throwing up, were super sick. It was really, really bad. And a number of deaths because of lack of medical care since 2003 is 167. So the family detention center. So as I said before, there are currently three family detention centers in the United States. One is Berks, which is the only one that is run by the federal government or operated. And then Carnes and South Texas Family Detention Center, or known as Dilley. So just as a brief history, because it's really good to have a context of what's the legal basis of the United States to detain children and mothers, right? So in the 1980s, a lot of refugee children were coming to the United States, right? So there were so many that were being detained without even like having an attorney or having any family members to accept them in their homes, that two organizations in 1985 sued the federal government, and after more than 10 years of litigation, they agreed to the Florida settlement, which is constantly violated because it says that if there's a facility that is going to house children, it has to be licensed for the care of children, right? So what they did is that if you if the child wasn't an unaccompanied child, it didn't come with the parents, then they were transferred to ORR, which is the Office of Refugee Resettlement, which is not anymore under the Department of Homeland Security, but under the Department of Human Services, right? But if you, if the child came with the parent, then they created the Berks County Family Residential Center, which is the Family Detention Center. Residential Center, it's a very absurd name. And then they did Haro, which is, it was a former prison, medium level former prison, where they placed mothers and children who were looking for protection and looking for asylum in the United States. The conditions were so bad that they opened it like in July, and then they closed in December of 2006. So this was Haro. You can see the children and the family with uniforms. It's a prison. Then in 2014, because of all of the gang violence occurring in the Northern Triangle, which is Guatemala, El Salvador, and Honduras, a lot of children and mothers were coming right to the United States looking for protection. So what did Obama do? So the Obama administration opened more detention centers, right? So they opened Artesia, which is not anymore a family detention center, again, because of really bad conditions. And they expanded the capacity for Berks. And again, it's, I mean, 70% do not have legal representations, conditions are not suitable. They were licensed at some point, but in 2016, district judge said, like, this is ridiculous, this is not a childcare facility. So they're not licensed anymore. So this is Berks Family Detention Center in Pennsylvania. And then Carnes. Carnes was also a former prison, and now it's a residential center. I used to work here too. So they opened in August of 2014. And again, it's not licensed for the care of children. The Texas Department of, I don't know exactly the name, the Family Protective Services licensed them. And then, yeah, I mean, I will explain that later. But it's managed by GEO, and the capacity, I believe, is, I'm sorry. So yeah, as you can see the picture, that's they detained babies, toddlers, and this is Carnes inside. And then we have Dili. So as you can see, it's really bad. At some point, when they opened around the beginning of 2015, they were detaining so many people because it was still under construction when they opened. So that they had to place children and families just with our beds sleeping in the floor. The capacity to 2,400, and it's core civic, and again, it's not licensed, but they tried to provide a license, but they a judge said, like, no, this is insane. After, the women did a hunger strike, which was really... yes, this is Dili. It's basically made out of trailers in the middle of Texas. Like, there's nothing. I used to live in San Antonio, and in order for me to go there, I had to drive 2 hours, and for Carnes, an hour and a half. So not many people know about these demographics. The average population, 6 years old. 6 years old is the average population at the family detention centers. 88% have asylum claims, like good asylum claims, because you can say, oh yeah, I'm afraid to go back to my country, but you need to comply or meet the requirements for asylum, right? 88% have good asylum claims. And then most of the families have ties in the United States, meaning that they have some type of family members, but sometimes the family members do not have documents, so they cannot provide them documentation to assure that the person is going to go to that place. And of course, like, most of them do not have criminal records. And current updates, as I was explaining, just now. I think this is very important. So the Flores settlement, remember, it was 1997. These facilities were not licensed for so many years and were detaining, but they were violating the Flores settlement. So in 2015, a federal judge again said, you guys are violating the Flores settlement, and said that children cannot be detained for more than 20 days, right? And then this was when crimes and dealing detention centers, since they faced closure and they were making so much money, their lobbyists, people went to talk to Mario Lujo, and then the Department of Family Protective Services provided the license to Carnes and Billy. But then, this was in February of last year, but then in December of 2016, a Texas District Court basically blocked Texas from issuing these licenses, saying that, yes, you have the power to operate childcare facilities, but not prison facilities. And these are not childcare facilities, these are prisons. So that was good. But now, Texas legislators are trying to ease the requirements to be a childcare facility just so they can remain, so these two detention centers can remain open. So, but then recently, the government, I don't know if this is too legal, but the government filed an appeal saying that because there were a lot of children under the ORR custody, the unaccompanied children, who were detained because, you know, like maybe like a juvenile offense or something like that, and they were, since they were minors, they were placed in under ORR custody, and they are detained indefinitely. So what they were trying to do is, they should have a bond hearing, right? And the government, their argument was like, oh no, because of the Florida settlement, they lost that because it's no longer under the Department of Homeland Security jurisdiction, therefore they don't have the right to a bond hearing. But the Ninth Circuit, God bless the Ninth Circuit, ruled that no, they should have bond hearings because they are detained, and even though they are under ORR custody, they still should have the opportunity to have their case or their custody be decided by a neutral judge and not by someone else, like an officer, a government official. So, and another thing that they are considering is separating children from their mother. So if a mom comes with a child, or if I comes with a child, instead of placing them in the same detention center, then what they are considering, the government, the federal government, is to take the custody of the child and put it under ORR, and then keep the mothers at the family detention centers, which I think is a horrible violation of human rights. Yeah. So that's basically it. There's way more information, but I can speak about that later.
Which country?
United States. Well, originally from Colombia.
Colombia?
But yeah, I live in San Francisco right now.
I see. But you were born in USA?
No, I was born in Colombia.
I see. Immigrated to USA.
Yes.
I see.